final proposals for the construction of a tramway around the Hill of Howth were prepared by the chief engineer of the Great Northern Railway, W.H. Mills, on December the 23rd, 1896. The Dublin and Rada Railway Company decided to send a branch line to serve the new harbour in Howth, with a hope of gaining the lucrative traffic engendered by the mail boat. The first steam train arrived in Howth on the 30th of May, 1847. Too late, however, as the packet steamers now berthed across the bay at Dunlera. There was a time when every major street in Dublin had grooved or sunken tram rails laid in granite sets or cobblestones, exactly as these narrow gauge tracks, which once served Guinness's brewery and which may still be seen. Such tracks in Dublin City are now becoming increasingly rare. On the 1st of February 1872, the first Dublin horse tram ran from College Green to Garvel Avenue, Rathcar, and within a short number of years had fanned out in all directions. The first electric cars were open-fronted like the horse trams. Later, the first floor was extended, and the platform enclosed with a windscreen, and these became the open toppers. The balcony cars appeared in the early 20s and soon followed the standards, with their upper deck completely enclosed. Finally, the metal-clad luxury drams or streamliners appeared in the early 30s. The hill trams were open top and painted in crimson lake and ivory. Before the First World War, they became varnished mahogany, and by the Second World War they appeared in their final livery of blue and cream.
Your voice is sweet like violins and warm like summer days. I love you, and oh, so many, many ways. Your touch is like a breath of spring. You give life to my soul. To me, sweetheart, you're everything I ever hoped to hold. A smile from you lights up my heart and brightens all my days. And I just love you, I love you, I love you, and oh,
Number 4 is preserved in beautiful condition in the Belfast Transport Museum. The air brakes feeder pipes.
I told you, baby, how I feel.
The black control box.
Baby, be my queen.
queen of hearts. Please give me that love.
The ratchet type handbrake with brass swan neck handle.
Make me feel good, kiddo. Maybe I'm just wasting
the bullseye paraffin lamp with movable shades to show green, white or red. And the green meant car to follow. The air brakes pressure gauge. The tumble home rocker panel. The trellis type platform folding gate. The bulkhead drop window with three brass protection rails.
Kiddo, don't you know that's wrong? I can't stand this.
The saloon was richly ornate with varnished timber. There was a monitor roof, which is a form of clerestory lighting, with amber glass pivoted ventilators.
If you love me, let me know. Won't you say yes? Don't you say no?
The upper deck had reversible garden seats with timber lats and swivel backrests. And the deck was surrounded with timber and steel decency boarding and high wire caging unique to the hill trams.
Kitty, oh, don't you know that's wrong? I can't stand this plane around. Help me up, don't.
Everything restored to perfect condition and everything exactly as it was.
If you love me, let me know. I want you say yes, don't you say no. Make me feel good, kiddo. Make me feel so good, so, so good, kiddo.
A blue and cream rail car arrives at Sutton and Baldoyle station, crowded with passengers wishing to travel on the trams.
Checking out a hotel loneliness. All my loneliness.
With an old carriage in the background, one of the blue and cream cars standing outside the depot in 1958, and inside a rare glimpse of the works car number 11. Numbers 5 and 8 off their bogies and partially scrapped. Number 7 sets off, shed, on her journey around the hill.
In that old lonely room.
An enthusiastic crowd are anxiously waiting as number 6 leaves the tram shed, her headlamp blazing and her gong sounding. At Sutton, some rather distinguished passengers board the tram.
I found you. I woke up dreaming of your friend kisses.
When passing Sutton Crossroads, the gong was sounded continuously. The majestic Shield Martin Hill rises in the background as the tram approaches Strand Road Loop.
Santa Sabina Convent can be seen between the trees.
Tramcars kept to the right-hand side when ascending Carrickback Road. The stretch of track from Strand Road to St. Fintan's Cemetery was straight and gently graded, and the trams usually travelled at top-notch along this section. With Tom Redmond at the controls, Colin Weaver is standing at the rear platform. The Golden Gorse is in full bloom, and a boat can be seen out to sea as the tram passes by.
A love as strong as mine can stand the test of time. Think twice.
This was one of the straightest sections of reserved line, and a good turn of speed could be expected. In cases of fog, the conductor would walk ahead of the tram, leading it through this dangerous junction with Carrickback Road. Passing under Ferry Hill Hospital, the tram once more entered its own private reserve. Number 5 stands at Stella Maris Loop as number 6 descends from the summit. Have you noticed, by the way, that every motor car we see is black? Number 10 passes out number 1 on her return to Sutton. The trams are now on their second reserve, and the climb is steady until the Hill of Howth summit is reached at last. Arriving at the summit, number 7 sets down another tram load of passengers. The blue and green tram cars were built by Brush Electrical of Loughborough and were delivered by British Westinghouse Electric and Manufacturing Company in 1901. The bogies or trucks were Brill 22E with two 37.5 horsepower Westinghouse Motors. On the tram seated 67 passengers. Motorman Jack Maypotter clears the section ahead on his return journey to Sutton. The summer crowds are growing a little impatient, and at last Dick McGlue is ready to continue the journey on to Howth. As number 7 crosses over Bulk Hill Road, you can see the trolley pole being pulled down. To this particular dog, the trams were most unpopular. This is Kruger's Cutting, called after the famous Boer War hero in the news when the cutting was being formed. Back at Island View, Jack Maypotter tosses a pack of gold flake to Tommy Whelan. Pass over the steel viaduct, we can see the lines of the old Howth tram number 31 on the road beneath. For many people, this will be their last journey on the Hill of Howth trams, and deep in the hearts of most, there is a feeling of sadness as they know the end of the line is near. The youngest motorman was Michael Fitzpatrick. With Tom at the controls, we climb steadily out of the station and on our way. On this notice, the passengers are requested not to spit in or on the trams. Willie O'Brien was known to everyone as Showery because of his constant remarks about the weather. We are passing Offington Wood and Howth Castle, the seat of the St. Lawrence family, on the right. Wrapped up well in our black cloak, the gatekeeper's wife, Mrs. Hopkins, passes by as number four reaches the summit.
Your voice is sweet like violins and warm like summer days. I love you, and oh, so many, many ways.
The summer crowds abound, waiting for the next downhill car.
A breath of spring.
They return from the summit to summit, with Dublin Bay and the Wicklow Mountains in the distance. A gentle sea breeze and the fragrant smell of the heather was an exhilarating experience, not easily to be forgotten. The gong sounds as the tram crosses Carrickblack Road to enter the Bailey Reserve. Two of the blue cars meeting at the Bailey. Barron Hill Loop projected well into the roadway and caused a bottleneck in heavy summer traffic. We are passing Howth Golf Club on the right-hand side. We are overlooking the lands of the future Carrickbrack and Offington Estates. Last Sutton Cross is reached. This building is, of course, now Superquins. Christmas 1958. This is the early morning mass tram, and as you can see, the milkman is also at mass. Every year, tramcar number 3 was beautifully decorated with tinsel and holly by Bob O'Connor and Billy Rankin. After dark, with Christmas tree aglow and fairy lights winking, the tram looked like something out of a fairy story. The final day dawned at last, and crowds of people anxiously thronged the way to have a last glimpse and journey on the famous Hill of Howth electric tramcars and bid them a fond farewell. They said the trams were obsolete, and in the name of progress, that they had to go. After 60 years of faithful service in Howth, the tram had become part of the community. And when the line was closed down in May 1959, the people of Dublin were greatly saddened. An old friend had departed. Although the hill trams have long since been replaced by buses, in the hearts of many, they will never be forgotten.
How a word can mean everything.
I was at boarding school when the line closed. I didn't know. I got on my bicycle and cycled out to Sutton Cross to see the trams and acquaint myself with an old friend. And this is what I found. I sat down on an old tram pole and wept bitterly. This was wrong. This could have been a wonderful tourist attraction. And there, in the distance, the replacement bus stood proudly. It was the end.
Whatever you do, a love as strong as mine can stand the test of time. Think twice of the one who loves you.